Hello aspirants, looking at current affairs for 10th March, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 8. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Supreme Court upholds passive euthanasia. So this is regarding the landmark ruling of the Supreme Court. The 5-judge constitutional bench headed by Chief Justice of India Deepak Mishra has given this ruling in which it has upheld passive euthanasia and right to give advance medical directives or living wills. So this will smoothen the process of dying. It is considered as part of right to life, to that it is a right to live with dignity. So that means you have to die in dignity as such. So that is also a right which you have. So that is why passive euthanasia has been allowed. Active euthanasia has not. So active euthanasia is still not legally allowed in the country. But passive euthanasia means that death, causing death, but then passive means that only the medical support is withdrawn or withheld, so that the patient, because there is no hope for revival or cure now, so the patient can die when this medical support is withdrawn. So that is called passive euthanasia. So this has been allowed, and also right to give advanced medical directives like living wills, as we have discussed them earlier too. We'll discuss them once again right now too. So this has been allowed under Article 21. Right to life. So it is been argued, the judges also gave their verdicts, giving their opinions, that meaningful existence includes a person's right to self-determination and autonomy to decide his medical treatment. So it has also said that though religion, morality, philosophy, law and society have conflicting opinions about whether right to life includes right to die, but then they all agree that person should die with dignity. So this is what the Supreme Court is also allowing, interpreting Article 21 of the Constitution, right to life, in an expanded form, that it includes to right to die with dignity. So also the exact stage at which this would be allowed, that person, you know, can have passive euthanasia. So this is when the treating physicians and the family members know fully well that the treatment is administered only to procrastinate the continuum of breath, means to extend. And the patient is not even aware that he is breathing. So in such cases, passive euthanasia can be allowed. So passive euthanasia is allowed, suicide and active euthanasia are still illegal. So active euthanasia is unlawful, has been clearly stated by the court. And also suicide, which includes which is unnatural death, is also illegal as such. Also, what is this living will? You should understand. So living will, a will generally comes into effect when the person has died. So will, which we generally understand, it talks of inheritance. But this living will, which is spoken of, is an advanced medical directive, which is given when the person is alive, that when he is in such a situation that he cannot decide for himself, he's already decided what procedure should be used for him for, you know, medical treatment as such. So this will smoothen the dying processes. So when a person becomes terminally ill or is in a permanent vegetative state, so then this living will as such be put into effect. So presently there are fears because there's a criminal liability if relatives, medical doctors, they encourage or they enter into passive euthanasia, there are fears. So then people suffer, patient suffers and has an undignified death. So that is why the Supreme Court is saying that we are allowing this. It has clearly given the procedure about how living will be put into effect. So we will see that too. Here you can see that this advanced medical directive or living will, as it is called, means who can make it is an adult with a sound and healthy mind. It should be voluntarily executed based on informed consent. And also it should have clear and unambiguous terms. It should be expressed in clear and unambiguous terms. What will be the content of this living will? That circumstances in which treatment should be withheld or withdrawn. Number one, it will specify that the will can be revoked at any time. Number two, and it will name the guardian or close relative who will go ahead, give the go ahead for starting passive euthanasia. And how will this will be preserved? It will be attested by 2 witnesses and preferably countersigned by a FCJM, that is first class judicial magistrate. So this magistrate will also preserve one hard copy and one soft copy and forward it to the district court registry. When a copy will be given to local government official who shall nominate the custodian for the will. So this is the detailed procedure which the Supreme Court has laid down regarding this living will or advance medical directive, and how to put it into effect is also a detailed procedure which is being discussed in this article. Passive euthanasia verdict, it will be the doctor's call. So number one, it will be the responsibility of the treating doctor to ascertain the genuineness or authenticity of the living will of the terminally ill patient. And this will be done through the judicial magistrate in whose custody the document is kept. So this is number one. Then after the doctor decides that the living will needs to be acted upon, it is his responsibility to convey to the guardian or close relative the medical condition, the availability of care, consequences, alternative forms of treatment, and also consequences of remaining untreated. So once the doctor has decided upon that the living will be acted upon. Also, then after that, he has to constitute a medical board comprising of the head of treating department and at least three experts in neurology, nephrology, cardiology, oncology, etc., the specific fields. And then members, experts should have at least 20 years of experience in the profession. So they will visit the patient and give a preliminary opinion of whether or not this living will should be acted upon or not. So this medical board would be formed. After the medical board has been formed, if it decides not to follow the living will, it will give its opinion to the district collector concerned. And district collector also, and if this support the living will and they say yes, passive euthanasia has to be performed, still they will inform the district collector, and then the district collector will have to form another medical board with chief district medical officer as chairman and endorse the decision. Also, then this decision will go to the JMFC, that is first class judicial magistrate, and then the decision can be put into effect. Also, magistrate will also have to visit the patient and finally authorize the implementation of this decision. So this is the elaborate procedure in which living will would be put into effect. Also, same procedures to be followed for those also who do not have a living will and passive euthanasia decision has been taken. So same procedure is there for them. So this detailed procedure has been laid down by the Supreme Court through which the passive euthanasia can be conducted. So this is there. Also, another thing which you should know is that this will be effective till the government makes a law on the matter. So we have already seen earlier too that living will has been argued in the court, and presently the Supreme Court has given its judgment in which it is accepting living will, but the government is against it, saying that it can be misused. But then with this detailed procedure in place, it is expected that the misuse would be eliminated. There will be no concern of misuse as such. Plus also, the government, once it makes a law, then that would be effective. Until the government makes a law on the matter on passive euthanasia, the Supreme Court's ruling would be effective. So this is there. Also, the Supreme Court, another point which you should know is that it gives the individual the right to withdraw or alter his living will, but this will also be done in writing. So this also is there. Then here you can see the forms of euthanasia are discussed. So this is called physician assisted suicide. So in various countries, various forms of such euthanasia are there. Voluntary active euthanasia is when a physician administers a medication such as a sedative or a neuromuscular relaxant to intentionally end the patient's life with the mentally competent patient's explicit request. So this is active euthanasia, that the patient is fine, he is in a mentally competent state, and on his request the physician, the doctor, is giving some medication which will result in death. So that is called voluntary active euthanasia. Then there is involuntary or non-voluntary active euthanasia, means again the patient is administered some medication which will result in end of his life, but then it is not with the patient's request, but patient cannot decide for himself, but then this decision is taken. And the physician assisted suicide, so this is when the physician provides medication at his or her explicit request of the with the understanding that the patient intends to use the medication to end his or her life. So then physician is providing the medication. He's not himself administering, but providing the medication to the patient. So these forms of euthanasia are actually not allowed in the country. What the Supreme Court has allowed presently is only passive euthanasia. And this is actually regarding the prominent case of Aruna Shanbhag, a nurse from KEM hospital who was sexually assaulted by a ward boy in 1973. And after that, she remained in a vegetative state following that assault in 1973. Till in 2009, actually a petition was filed in the Supreme Court seeking passive euthanasia, that treatment should be stopped for her so that she can die peacefully. Finally, in 2011, Supreme Court allowed passive euthanasia too. But then it was not acted upon. The nurses who were taking care of this former nurse of KM Hospital, Aruna Shanbhag, they refused to let her die. And finally, in 2015, she died due to a cardiac arrest. So, actually, in 2011, Supreme Court had already allowed passive euthanasia. And these are regarding laws in various other countries regarding euthanasia. So, Netherlands became the first country to legalize euthanasia and assisted suicide. So, as we saw in another image also, that this is allowed in Netherlands, involuntary active euthanasia. So, this is where US doctors are allowed to prescribe lethal doses of medicine to terminally ill patients in 5 states in the USA. But euthanasia is illegal. So, this is there. Then Germany, physician-assisted suicide is legal, as we saw here. This is legal in Germany. And this is actually showing laws regarding euthanasia in various countries. In Netherlands, Netherlands was actually the first country which allowed euthanasia as such. In USA also, some states allow euthanasia. Germany, we already saw. South Korea also since 2018 has allowed euthanasia. But there are some countries where euthanasia is illegal. So these are UK, Australia, New Zealand and Philippines. Then the next news item is Trump accepts Kim's stock offers. So this is regarding US President Donald Trump accepting that he will meet North Korean leader Kim Jong-un in May 2018 in a summit. So this will be a diplomatic channel opened up for a solution to the nuclear stalemate on the Korean Peninsula. We have been seeing that Kim Jong-un, the North Korean leader, has been testing missiles, nuclear missiles, and denuclearization is what is sought in the Korean Peninsula. So a step ahead in this direction through talks has been put forth. So this is the first time that a sitting American president will meet a North Korean leader. So Mr. Kim, as we saw, the diplomatic channel was opened. The Olympics, Winter Olympics were used where South Korean and North Korean Olympic participants participated together as a single team from Korea in some events. And now Mr. Kim has had a meeting with the South Korean National Security Advisor in which he said that he is committed to denuclearization of Korean Peninsula and no longer objected to joint military exercises by South Korea and US. So this message has been put forward to Donald Trump too. Also he said that he'll refrain from further nuclear and missile testing as well. So this is a positive development which has come forth. So they have been, both the leaders, Kim Jong-un and Donald Trump, have been hurling insults at each other publicly in the last few months. And now there are steps being taken. North Korea had also tested nuclear missiles, which experts say were threatening even mainland America. And in September 2017, Mr. Trump had threatened to totally destroy North Korea. But of course, a military solution is not the way out, because any American military action would have its repercussions and would be catastrophic for its allies, South Korea and Japan, which are neighbors of, close to North Korea. So this is there. So now talks could be initiated in May. So this has been welcomed by various leaders. EU spokesperson and German Chancellor Angela Merkel have also welcomed this announcement. So this is regarding the history as such too. So Korean Peninsula was actually under the occupation of Japan, and in 1945, when Japan was defeated in the Second World War, its Korean occupation ended, and after that the Korean Peninsula was divided between Soviet backed regime and the US supported regime in north and south. So this division was along the 30th parallel latitude. So this is before North and South Korea. In 1950, North Korea was also assisted by China and it invaded South Korea, but US retook the region. Then US coalition as such. So the such developments took place. This is the Cold War era result that North and South Korea have been formed. A spy ship was also captured by North Korea, which belonged to US, and later the members were released. So even a US aircraft was shot down by North Korea. Finally, the contact initiative was taken to resolve this conflict by former US President Jimmy Carter in 1994 when he visited North Korea. And then later, North Korea also cooled down. There were positive developments. It put a moratorium on military nuclear program as such too, which it was having. And then finally, when former US President George Bush became the president, he labeled North Korea, Iran and Iraq as axis of evil. Suppose that in 2006, we saw that North Korea conducted its first nuclear test. And after that, we have seen that President Donald Trump, when he has come to power again, he's spoken of fire and fury will be lashed out on North Korea. North Korea conducted, he declared that North Korea cannot develop nuclear weapons which can reach US territory, and North Korea conducted tests for intercontinental ballistic missiles which could reach US territory. Then after that, again North Korea has conducted its sixth nuclear test too in September 2017, and now the initiatives are being taken and talks are being initiated which are being positively looked forward to. Then next is week ends without business in parliament. So this is regarding the second leg of the parliamentary session going on, the budget session which is presently going on. So in this second leg, it is expected that the finance bill of 2018, which is part of the budget, would be passed and the demand for grants would be approved. So the budget has to be passed. But in the first week of the second leg of the session, budget session, we are seeing that the parliament has been has not been able to function. Both the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha are seeing protests by opposition members, various political parties protesting for various reasons. So all parties except ruling BJP and its ally Akali Dal have been protesting both in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha for the entire week. So you can see the Telugu Desam Party and the YSR Congress, the party in opposition in Andhra Pradesh, both these political parties have been protesting since the start of the budget session for special category status for Andhra Pradesh. So they are there. Then AIDMK and DMK from Tamil Nadu, the two political parties, are demanding that Kaveri Management Board be formed immediately after the Supreme Court gave its verdict on the Kaveri water dispute. So they have also been protesting the entire week. Congress and Trinamool Congress have been protesting on the Punjab National Bank scam, that government should take immediate action on this fraud which has taken place, the 12,700 crore fraud. So they are protesting. Shiv Sena, the political party from Maharashtra, is protesting that and demanding classical language status for Marathi language. So for various reasons, various political parties are protesting. You should know classical language status has been accorded to some languages in the country. The first language to be accorded this classical language status was Tamil in 2004. Then in 2005, Sanskrit was given this status. So presently there are these six languages: Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Malayalam, the four southern languages, Sanskrit and Odia. Odia was the latest one given this status in 2014. So these six languages are classical languages of India. So Marathi is also being asked to be given the same status now. Then next is Rajasthan passes bill to give death penalty for child rape. So Rajasthan has become the second state after Madhya Pradesh which has passed this bill to have death penalty accorded to convicts in raping who are accused of raping girls of 12 years and below. So this criminal laws Rajasthan amendment bill has been passed by the state legislative assembly. It seeks to amend the Indian Penal Code, IPC. So new sections are being proposed to be inserted. So these will be applicable to Rajasthan. So IPC is applicable to the entire country. So this amendment can be done by Rajasthan State Legislative Assembly, but it will need approval of the president. So bill will become a law only after it gets presidential assent. So this actually is awaited. So Rajasthan has been saying that the crimes here, actually National Crime Records Bureau also shows that cases of crimes against children have been steadily increasing in Rajasthan, and this law has been initiated to act as a deterrent against crimes against children. Deterrent for that. So this is even the 2011 census data regarding, victims of sexual abuse and in the age group criteria to below 18 and above 18. So, then next is e-wallet remittances business slump in the wake of KYC fiat. So this is regarding the recent RBI directive, which we have already discussed. In October 2017, RBI had asked all PPIs, prepaid payment instruments provide issuers, to make all accounts fully KYC compliant by December 31, 2017. Later, this deadline was extended to February 28, 2018, and now this deadline has expired. So fully KYC compliant accounts can only function. Otherwise, the RBI said that whatever amount is there presently in the account, it can be used, but further refilling will not be allowed. So this has affected the businesses. The remittances and e-commerce transactions have come down significantly. You can see they have shrunk by 70%. Remittances, e-commerce transactions have halved. E-wallets transactions have come down by 80%. So this is because full KYC compliance would take time. E-KYC is simple. There is e-KYC and full KYC. So e-KYC means any one officially valid document like passport, voter ID card, driving license, or even Narega job card can be provided for verification. And otherwise Aadhaar number. If Aadhaar number is not there, then any one of these officially valid documents can be used for e-KYC. But full KYC means complete authentication and verification of residence, identity proof is required. So this is a costly affair. So that is why the PPIs have not been able to comply with it, and the business is suffering, is being put forth. Actually, we had seen RBI at that time had said that this is essential for KYC compliance, so that interoperability can also be brought in. That whatever is there, money in the wallets, that can be made interoperable. That from various wallets, you can shift your money. Move money from one wallet to the other. Then later, RBI also intends to make interoperability between wallets and bank accounts possible. So you can shift money from your bank account into the wallet and from the wallet into bank account. And finally, even wallets and cards, credit debit cards. So this interoperability is being proposed by RBI. So that is why it says full KYC compliance is essential. The PPI issuers, prepaid payment instrument issuers, have been arguing that let Aadhaar become mandatory. Once that is put into effect, then Aadhaar will have KYC compliance will be ensured through Aadhaar. So that is there. So this was the RBI directive in October 2017. Complete KYC compliance by end of December 2017. Those not completing the process can keep only 10,000 in their wallet, and no credit facility if users don't become KYC compliant in 12 months. So this is the minimum net worth of these PPIs who are allowed. So even prepaid payment instrument providers, who are they? They are also RBI has issued guidelines. So these 55 non-bank mobile wallets are there who have been issued licenses by RBI, and even 50 banks have their own wallets. So these are the entities which are having these e-wallets. And it is said cost of KYC, full KYC, is around 150 to 200 per user. So this is there. And full KYC compliance for such small ticket transactions, they are actually a deterrent to use of e-wallets. So cumbersome process which people may not prefer. So e-wallets usage would be affected. It increases customer acquisition costs also. And they wanted, the industry members had asked, the deadline be extended till telecom companies link Aadhaar to mobile number. So then KYC compliance would become easier. Then next is only about 50% PAN cards linked to Aadhaar. So PAN cards being linked to Aadhaar, the latest deadline which is being given by the government is 31st March 2018 and less than a month is available now for this deadline to be reached. And it is said so far only about 50% of the PAN cards issued have been linked to Aadhaar. So this is a very low number, but of course we have already seen that mandatory requirement cannot be there on Aadhaar till the Supreme Court gives its verdict, and Supreme Court is still hearing the matter. So this is there in case of NEET also. NEET applications, we saw that mandatory requirement of Aadhaar cannot be there. So mandatory linking of Aadhaar to PAN cards may also have to be delayed if Supreme Court does not give its final verdict on Aadhaar before that. So this is there. And the last news item is government to split Air India debt ahead of stake sale. So this is the Minister of State for Civil Aviation, Mr. Sinha, saying that government has actually given in principle approval in 2017 itself that Air India would be sold off because there is a huge debt on it and it has been going on because of the government support. So the bailouts which have been provided is what is making, what is allowing it to go on. But then it has a debt burden and a bloated cost structure. So that is why it needs to be sold off. But then its debt, which is their $8.5 billion debt, this actually will be segregated. The split of the debt would take place into sustainable and unsustainable debt. So sustainable debt is fine, which can be taken care of. The unsustainable part will go to a special purpose vehicle. So this initiative would be taken by the government before selling off the stake in Air India. So as you can see, there is 45,000 crore debt of Air India, which is $8.5 billion in terms of dollars. And out of this, you can see 14,000 crore is aircraft loans. Then there are non-convertible debentures of 7,500 crore. And 4,000 crore is annual interest service liability of Air India. So now debt should be made, sustainable part should be taken care of, and unsustainable part should be an SPV through which, you know, steps need to be taken that how can this be made viable, and then the selling off would take place. The entire Air India would not be sold off in one go. So that is already known. So these are the news items. Thank you.